name is Aviyah Ben Israel, and this testimony that you're about to hear is how I came into the truth, consciousness, and understanding who I am as a child of the Most High, Yah. Like most of us, I was raised in the church to believe that Jesus and God are who we're supposed to believe in. I always had some issue with it, but I could never understand why. After going through years of searching through Islam, through nationalism, through Jehovah's Witness, I went back to Christianity, and my life became no better than what it was when I was trying out those other things. I always knew that there was a power greater than myself. I just didn't know where or how to find it. I went through a period of, like most everybody, a wildness in my life. But in that wildness of my life, I was always seeking, because I knew the things that I was doing was not according to the way I was supposed to live. So one of the things I was always saying, if you have the faith of a mustard seed, leap out on faith and you can do or find out whatever goes supposed to do. During my time, I was an addict. I was an addict for 30 years. And during my time as an addict, I was always wanting to stop getting high. So in stop getting high, I always use that phrase, faith of a mustard seed, and you can start. You can get out of what you're doing. Eventually, the Father, Aviyah, woke me up and brought me out of my drug addiction. And when he did that, I had to replace the emptiness in me, so I went back to church. So as I was going back to church, there were still some things missing, because what the minister was saying was not always lining up to my spirit, or today I call it the Ruach. So I happened to be on the usher. And I was standing in the back of the church, and all of a sudden, I started saying, "Here am I, send me, here am I, send me." There was a song being played, and I don't remember the name of the song, but I said, "Here am I, send me." And I just kept on repeating that over and over and over. So after that, I would say about 2 months, 3 months later, one of the deacons in the church came to me and asked me if I wanted to go to this course down Temple University. He had met a professor down there, and he was teaching a course called Forensic Christianity. I was a student of the Bible when I was in the church. I was going through an evangelistic course that took 3 years. And one of the things that I was asked him was that if Paul, that the world called, whose Hebrew name is actually Shaul, was apostle to the Gentiles, and I know that the Gentiles is today I know the Gentiles are the white race. If he was apostle to the Gentiles, and if you look at any good Bible, his journeys was all up in Europe. So I said to my teachers, if Paul was apostle to the Gentiles and they're the white people, what was the black people doing? And they could not give me an answer. So when a deacon came to me and talked about the course down Temple University, about forensic Christianity, he asked me, did I want to go? So I said, yes. So being a good sheep of the congregation that I belong to, we went and asked the pastor if we could go to this class down at the Temple. And he says, yes, education is a good thing. Go with my blessing. So the course, like I said, was Forensic Christianity. It was a 10-week course. So when I got finished with the course, I came back to the pastor and I opened up the Bible. I said, these are the things that I learned, that we were the Hebrew Israelites, that the son's name is Yahushua, the father's name is Yah, and Christianity was started by a man called Constantine, who actually stole our heritage, or not our heritage, who stole our knowledge, and was giving it back to us, twisted. And he said to me, with an arrogant attitude, you're right, you know. So I said to him, well, how come you're not teaching us this? And he says, well, I'll teach the congregation what they need to know when I think they need to know it. So I got mad. And when I got mad, because of the fact that he told me that I gave this man my eternal soul to God, and he's sitting up here every Sunday lying to me. And I questioned him about that, you know, and he says, I have forgotten more than what I'll ever know. So it really got under my skin that he had the nerve to even say these things. And unfortunately, it was just him and myself. So when I got up to leave, because I had no place or didn't know what to do, I said, as soon as the Father give me some place to go, I'm out of here. So I got up to leave his office, and he said to me that at least we did something right. And I said, what's that? He says, at least now you know the truth. And I said, well, you did not give it to me. And I said, well, I'm going to pray for you in Jesus' name. And I really went off then. Because he says, well, I said, don't pray for me in Jesus' name, because he don't have no power. Something that he says himself, you know. And I said some other things that made him want to put his hands on his desk, like he wanted to raise up from his desk. And I looked at him with the look like, please do. Because once again, I had entrusted myself unto you, and you want to stand up there and lie to me. From this day forward, or from that day forward, I refer to those people that know the truth and do not give the truth to the people as Satan's servants. Because why would you not tell me who I am if you were given charge over me to direct me? So, not too long after that, I think about three Sundays after that, we were sitting in Sunday school, and the Sunday school teacher said something, and I was correcting her. And she got mad, and she sat down and told me to get up and teach the class. So, I didn't have enough. If I had gotten up and said what I knew, would have been efficient at that particular time. But I didn't say nothing. I sat there. And 2 weeks later, I left the church. So I'm looking online. No, let me back up. The same professor who taught down temple, he was having classes, teaching Shabbat classes. You know, so I was going there to his house, and he was showing reading and showed me passages in the Bible that dealt with who I was, but not totally. He was teaching against Christianity, but in some practices, doing Christianity. You know, talking about offerings, but more or less accepting tithes. Talking about keeping the Shabbat, but class didn't start till after Saturday night. You know, so I'm still worshiping on a Sunday according to scripture. So when I pointed these things out to him, we was able to get over that hurdle. And I was taking him to the airport one night, and I was speaking out of the Old Testament. And he said to me that there's nothing in the Old Testament that I can tell him about, because he don't believe in the Old Testament. said, okay, here we go again. I picked him up when he came back from the airport, and that was the last time I went over to his house for anything. I do stop to talk to him every now and then to see how he's doing, you know, because I still need to keep in contact with these people who Yah used to put me on the path of righteousness, because you never know when they're going to be turned to the total truth also. So I was wondering, what am I going to do? What am I going to do? And I was online looking up Hebrews, the histories of the Hebrews. And I ran across a website by called HebrewIsraelites.org, ran by an organization called Israelite Heritage. And much to my surprise, I'm not an avid reader, but when something catches your attention and you know it's right, you do whatever it takes to get that information. And I had a hunger and a thirst for who I was and what I was going through. And when I ran across the information on the site, I started reading the information on the site. And before I knew it, I was into the next day. I had read everything that was on that site. And reading it, I felt free, I felt renewed, I felt finally, I know why I'm going through the things I'm going through, why my people going through the things that we're going through, and I have a better understanding on what I need to do with my life. With that being said, I no longer looked at myself as an African-American. I no longer looked at myself as a nigger. I no longer looked at myself as a Christian. But I looked at myself as a child of the Most High Yah. Psalm 68:4 says, singing to the Most High, sing praises to His name. Extol Him that ride upon the heaven by His name, Yah, and rejoice before Him. So I knew then that God was no longer in my vocabulary. When I learned that there was no J in the English language up until 1630, there was also no J in the Greek language, the Latin language, or the Hebrew language. So when I found out that, then I had to go find out, well, what was Jesus' name? And in Hebrew, his name was Yahushua. So I no longer use Jesus for the name of my brother, who was the son of Yah, who came to redeem us and wake us up from our sins. I'm trying to put all this stuff into perspective, you know. Sometimes it's hard to do that because there's so many things that run through your mind when you're trying to do an interview, but you can't get it all out at one time, or even in the order that it's supposed to be in. But I do know that when I finally found out who I was, it changed my whole life. You know, Like when I was using drugs. When I stopped using drugs, because drugs gave me a false understanding as to who I was and what the world was around me. You know, and I settled for that, you know, until I got clean. And after I got clean, I had to look at me and I had to look at the world around me and deal with it and the reality aspect of things. So that was the same thing that I had applied to understanding the scripture as it was given to us by our forefathers and who I was as a person. You know, it's good to know that I'm not the name of two continents. When everybody else around here is running around with a nationality. And I didn't have one. I was anything that was somebody called me. First it was a nigga, then Negro, then colors, then blacks, then African monkeys, and every now and then they would throw in a coon, a spear chucker, a porch monkey. You know, in Deuteronomy 30, 28, 37, it says that we would be a byword and a proverb in the land where we're going in. And what is a byword or a proverb? Anything that you are not. It also says that we would be an astonishment in that same scripture. So what is astonishment or is anything that's going to turn your stomach or make you say, that's a shame about him, or look up and say, as people will say, here come them niggas. Or take for instance my hair, which is called locks. Samson had 7 of them, but we allow other people to tell us that they're dreadlocks, as in dreadful hair. You know, that is no longer, and I correct people for that, because I let them know what they truly are. This is our natural culture. And if you look at some of the paintings of old, and you see the Egyptians and the Hebrews and the Syrians and the Hebrews and the Babylonians and the Hebrews, they look alike, and we all have either locked hair, or we have a fro, or we have corn rolls. These are things that we did even back in the day. You know, just finding out who I was, like, allowed me to look back on why things in the past didn't work out. You know, knowing the scriptures the way that is being taught to me today, today I read the whole Bible from cover to cover, or I look at the whole Bible from cover to cover. And while in the religion of Christianity, they touch briefly on the Old Testament, but they dwell a lot in the New Testament. So when I finally realized that I need to read the whole book, because I would use this analogy. If I had a newspaper, a daily newspaper, and I opened it up to the centerfold, and I tore it in half, and I gave a person over here, I had the back half, and I kept the front half, and I'm reading through the paper, and I see that there is a continuation, but the continuation is on the back half of the paper. So how am I going to find out what happens in the back half if I don't put that paper together? And the same thing applies with the person that has the back half of the paper. How can they read what began in the story if they don't put the paper together? So, using that analogy, for me, I have to read the whole Bible backwards and forwards to get the understanding of what happened, and then why it happened, and then how we're going to supposed to be redeemed from the things that we did. So going into the front part of the Bible, I understand why the things that we tried to do in my generation growing up in the 60s, the 50s, the 40s, the 70s, while the change that we thought was going to happen or we wanted to happen didn't happen. Deuteronomy 28, 15 to 68, the book of Leviticus, and all the prophets spoke about the children of Israel and what would happen to them if we did not obey the word of the Father. You know, when we came out of Egypt, He gave us His laws and commandments, and He told us that if we did these things that and kept His laws and commandments, that He would bless us. And if we didn't, He would curse us. So He gave us the curses of what would happen to us, and He said that they would be our identity until we turn back to Him. In Deuteronomy 28, it talks about we'll be going back to bondage and ships. And Isaiah talked about our children standing on the corner, going buck wild, that our women will rule over us, we have ineffective leaders. Jeremiah talked about our pastors, our ministers, leading us astray, scattering Yah's people because they know the truth and they're not giving us the raw meat that Yah gave to us. Talks about how our children be taken from us and given to other nations and people, how we would have ineffective leaders, that strangers would come in our community, they would own everything and we would own nothing. You know, it also spoke about how the organizations, the Panthers, and all the other civil rights movement, how these things did not actually work because of the curses that the Father had put upon us. So when He puts His hand down on us, there's not a man alive today, tomorrow, or forever that could take His hand off of us, because He is the creator of us all. And what He says goes no matter what. You can either do what He says do and be blessed, or don't do it and be cursed. The final blessing in the curses is to be with them in paradise, or to be live forever in the lake of fire. I choose to be in paradise. Hallelujah. But still in all, when He said that we would not prosper at anything we would put our hand to do, we see that that is happening now. You know, the Jim Crow age, the Civil Rights age, and the Revolutionary Age, all of it failed. Well, the Civil Rights and the Revolutionary Age failed. The Jim Crow Age was an age that was used to oppress us, as the scripture tells us that would happen to us. In my day and time, and I participated in some of those movements because I was never one that walked by the, I walked to the beat of my own drum the majority of my life. So I was never satisfied with what went on. If you treated me all right, then I treated you all right. You treated me bad, you discriminated against me, I didn't, no, let me stop that lie, because I did some things that I ain't had no business doing, but I repented for them when I found out what I was actually doing. Some of the things that why the world is what it is today is because we have gotten away, or we was never taught who we were, and the reason why we wasn't taught that is because, once again, we didn't know who we were. Because if we knew who we were, as far as the people of the book, we could have gone through less trauma than what we're going through today. Jeremiah 23:26, and I'm just going to paraphrase that. It talks about how the prophet, false prophets, preachers, ministers, reverends, whoever you want to call yourself, did not stand in the counsel of the Most High or get a word from Him, but came to His people and said, I had a dream. And this is in the book. Don't take my word for it. Look it up for yourself. And if you think about it, and you had to get an understanding of the book, we were told not to integrate with no other nation or people. But because we had our own desires, desires of our own flesh and what we wanted to do, or what people wanted to do, they led us into situations that was totally against what the Father wanted us to do in the first place, and because of that we got punished. So when we integrated into this system, we became worser than the people who we was integrating with. So now, coming into this system, we're totally blind as to who we are and what we're supposed to be. And we got comfortable. We're very comfortable in living in a lie. So when we wake up and we try to give this truth to other people, as the Messiah told us to do, he said, go into all nations, teaching them all that I've taught you, and lo, I'll be with you to the end of the world. He says, but we're supposed to immerse them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the set apart Spirit. Okay. In this day and time, we have seen the last movement of trying to get out of our situation by ourselves. When the children of Israel went through the desert for 40 years, they relied strictly on Yah, and He supplied all their needs. Today we look to man to supply our needs. We look to a government to supply our needs. We look to everybody else to supply our needs but the Father. So we cannot do that. It's impossible for us to do that because we were created by Him, for Him, for us to worship Him, not for us to worship another man. And as soon as we get that out of our heads, you know, the better off we'll be. Okay. You know, one of the last movements that I was able to witness in Philadelphia is called the MOVE movement. Now, a lot of people might remember MOVE, if you remember MOVE, because there was a bomb dropped on their house. But it goes back before then. It was living in the section of the city called Palatin Village. And it was a Gentile section. No, it was not Gentile. It was a mixed community of Jews and Gentiles. But there was an organization that was moving back to living as we once lived. You know, they was totally off the grid. They didn't have phones. They didn't have televisions. They let the children run free. Some of them were did run the little children. They didn't clothe the little children. They complained about some of the children defecating in their yard, not out on the street. When they disposed of their food, they just threw it out the yard so it could decompose back into the ground. But in the same time, it drew rats. So, but yet, it drew cats because the cats fed off the rats. So it was the ecology that Yah had established was working for them. It was the fact that the people themselves didn't like it, that they complained about it. So the mayor of our town at that time, his name was Frank Rizzo, wanted the place tore down, or wanted to evict them. And yet when they came to do that, MOVE stood up for their rights. And there was a claim that there was shots fired and the police officer was killed. What happened, when the fire department did come first and they flooded the house, and there was water all in the basement because they forced them out of the second floor with all the water to go down to the basement. When they went down to the basement, they started flooding the basement with water. And then for some odd reason, there was some shots fired and they say it came from the house. But further investigations show that it did not come from the house first. But it is in the interim, a police officer was killed. And they really went on and shot up the house with bullets and water. And then those people that didn't want to drown when they came out, they brutally beat them and locked them up. Come to find out that the officer that was shot in the back by his own people. You know, there's all kinds of conspiracy theories that go on with that, but it might have been just a plain accident. So, and no sooner than, they locked everybody up, that very next hour, there was cranes and bulldozers knocking the house down, filling in the empty space with 24-hour guards around the place to keep anybody from digging up, looking for evidence, right? From then, it moved on for a couple years, I think it was 10 years from that time, out of West Philly where the second incident would move, and the Philadelphia Police Department, or the citizens of Philadelphia, complained about move. And this time they had a bunker on their house, and they was disturbing the community with bullhorns at night, and going through the same thing. And one of the things that they did because of the bunker, they wanted to dislodge the bunker. And I want you to understand, the first thing that happened, the first incident in the movie that happened, it was a Gentile mayor. The last time, it was under the orders of a Hebrew to drop this bomb on this house. You know, I don't remember the exact number of people that died, but it was women, children, men. I think probably, it might have been 13 people in the house, and six of them made that out alive. When they said, when the house caught on fire, when they tried to come out of the house, the police fired on them and forced them back into the house. You know, two of the people, Ramona Africa and Birdie Africa. Birdie Africa was the youngest of them, who died not too long ago. And Ramona Africa, she still is an activist today, trying to get the people who was jailed from the first incident out of jail. John Africa was the person who formed the MOVE organization, and his movement was like a Back to Africa movement here in the city. But go back to the curses. Yesterday, these things would happen to us. One of the things was that the authorities here would have no respect of a person. And any time that you see people dropping bombs on you, people being shot at, people that won't allow you to run for your life out of a burning building, they really have no respect for us as a people. They were Israel and didn't even know that they was Israel. They was carrying the burden of the curses, and it was right before our face, and we couldn't see it. All we saw was that they should not have done them black people that way. You know, the understanding as to who we are will keep that from happening in the future. You know, Yah tells us that no weapon formed against us will prosper. You know, it doesn't mean that it's not going to come together. The thing about it is, it will not be successful as to what it does. And even if it is a moment of oppression, you know, He would deliver us in His time. His word tells us that these people are going to pay for what they did to us. If it's in this time or when we stand before the throne of Yah, they are going to pay. That itself allows me to have comfort. That in itself allows me to turn the other cheek. I was not one for doing that before, but I can turn the other cheek. Mind you, that's in circumstances that I have an opportunity to walk away. If you come at me with in order to harm me, I'm gonna ask for strength to put you behind away. And that's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna pray for that strength. You know, David, when he slew Goliath, he did not turn his other cheek. And in that aspect, that we can defend ourselves, you know, but if you could walk away from an incident that's going to cause harm to you or someone else, why not? We're always told if you, one of the things I grew up in was a lot of old sayings that make sense today. He who fights and run away, live to fight another day, that's like turning the other cheek. Okay. I want to share what my name is. My name is Abiyah. And Abiyah means Yah is my father. It took me a minute to take on that name, but I want to share with you that when I was a youth, my father died when I was age 7, so I grew up without a father, and the male figures that I had in my life, one was an alcoholic, one was a womanizer, one was a gambler. And it turned out to be that all four men in my life, I turned out to be just like them. My father died, so I was an absentee father when my children was born or as they grew up because of my drug addiction and my alcoholism. And I was a womanizer while I was out there. And I was also a gambler, you know, so the lust of the flesh actually control my life. When I came into, when I became alcohol free and I substituted the truth for that lie, I was able to share some things with the family, what I thought was a family. And I'll get to that too. I never had a father, and how not having a father took me down the wrong path. And so I happened to be working on this job, and I was going down this dark road, and I heard his voice say to me, "Leslie, you have a father. I am your father." You know, and tears started streaming down my face. I would have pulled over and started shouting, "Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah," because now I know that I have a father. But the road that I was on, it was in a Gentile area. If I'd have made noise that early in the morning, I'd probably be still ducking bullets today. You know, so I just went on to work, and that whole day I felt good about who I was because I had a father. Even though it was not a physical father, it was a heavenly father, I understood that I was never alone, even through everything that I went through. So when I went to Satan's Den that following Sunday, I shared that, you know, with the people there in the congregation, and everybody was happy for me. It was not, they could not have been as happy as I was just to know that I had a father. So when I came into this truth, I was just looking at some things, and I was understanding small Hebrew, and I understood that Abba meant father, and Yah was the name of the father. You know, I says, okay. And then, about a year after finding Israelite heritage, the the organization, Israelite Heritage. They had, because I was listening to them online on Paltalk, in this Paltalk room called Yah and Yahushua Real. So I was always listening to them, and I didn't want to say anything because I did not know the workings of the room even after listening to it for about a year. You know, and I heard them talking about a gathering in Virginia, and being in Philly, Virginia is not too far. When I first got there, they was talking about the curses and how they was going to have a debut of the curses, their DVD in Texas. And I wanted to go there, but I just knew that Texas was too far. But when they said that they were going to have a gathering in Virginia, Williamstown, Virginia, that I was going to make. I knew there was nothing that was going to stop me from going, and I was there. Matter of fact, I got immersed there. And I was sharing with the assembly, because they had the elders and to come up and say something or give us a brief introduction as to who we were. And I didn't consider myself an elder because elders to me was somebody that was old. And I never considered myself to be that. I met this brother, and his name was Abiyah. So we was just talking, you know, and I asked him what his name was, and he says, Abiyah. And he started, and I said to him, yeah, that means Yah's my father. So I asked him, can there be more people, several people with the same name? And he said, yes. So I explained to him about my incident going down that dark road, about how I didn't grow up without a father. And I decided that day that Abiyah was going to be my name. And that is the name that I've taken since then. Abiyah ben Israel, which means Yah is my father, and I'm son of Israel, whose name was changed from Jacob to Israel. I hope that what I've shared with you is it helps enlighten some people as to who I am, how I got to where I'm at, and that there is no way in the world that I'm going back to the lie that was given to us because of our disobedient foreparents. You know, the scripture tells us that these things were going to happen to us, and that they would also unhappen to us if we turn back to the Father, repent, and He'll forgive our sins and heal our land. So, and that's 2 Chronicles 7:14. So when we was down in Virginia, we did just that. There was it was a very wonderful gathering. Matter of fact, I have never seen anything like that before when I went down there. I've seen it since, because when we come together out of love. We come together in on one mind, one accord. Some of the best, well-behaved children that I have seen in my life. There was no cussing, no fighting, no arguments, no loud, obnoxious music. You know, it's a beautiful thing. And this is not a movement. This is just us coming to understanding who we are, turning back to the Father. Letting the Father do for us the things that we can't do for ourselves. Letting the Father do for us the things that He said He would do for us. He said that He would bless us above all nations, that we were the apple of his eye. That if we do as he commanded us to do, there's nothing that we have to worry about. So with me understanding that and doing his will and not my own will, my life has been 100% better. I have been clean from drugs for 19 years. I've been in this walk for 5 years. And this 5 years is like I am a brand new child that's only 5 years old. When I became drug free, it was a new life. And I thought that it was nothing to be any better than that. But these last 5 years have been better than that. So two things. If you want the burden of this world off of you, and you want to enjoy true joy for the first time in your life, turn your will and your life over to Yah, Yahushua. Accept the fact that you are a Hebrew Israelite. Accept the fact, if you don't want to put a Hebrew on there, fine. Accept the fact that you are a Israelite, because that is your nationality. That is who you are. You are a chosen people, a nation of priests, who is supposed to take the love, the laws, and commandments of Yah to the other nations and not be downtrodden by them. We are the only ones who have no idea who we are, and everybody else do. And they, when I was young, we used to have these comic books, and in the back of the comic books, there's always this thin guy who was laying on the beach, and there's this muscular guy who always came and kicked sand in his face. You know, until I think it was that he started working out and became big, you know, and was able to defend himself. Well, that's who we are in a nutshell. We were that, and we still are to a point, because not everybody know who they are, and people don't care who they are. You know, they're just happy with the situation that they're in. I am no longer that person that's happy with the situation they're in. I am the one that was tired of getting the sand kicked in his face, got up and started doing something about building my strength up, building who I am up, and now I'm standing up. I am a David against Goliath, and I will slay Goliath as many times as he come before me. You know, there's a song that we sing that of our set apart music, and the ending of the song says that how our grandparents told us, son, you're going down the wrong road, but don't worry, things will get better further down the road. Well, the song going to say, after you analyze the statement, it says, you're on the wrong road. So how can things get better when you're on the wrong road? You literally have to get off that road. All right, Gil Scott Heron, who was a poet, a rapper, made a statement, says that it doesn't matter how far down the road you have gone, you can always turn around. I've gone down a long road. I happen to be a young 63 years old, and I've gone down a long road. And I just want to let you know, it's possible to turn around, get off that road, and get on the road, a right road. So fam, I ask that you examine yourself, look at the scripture in a different way, look at yourself as someone who's loved by the Creator, someone who's loved by Yah, and accept who you are, accept your punishment, and come back to the Father. You know, you can always look in the scripture and find out who you are. But it's always best to have somebody to help you, show you who you are. And you can do that by looking at the website that will follow this presentation and find information that you want. May Yah bless you. May Yah guard you. May His face look upon you and give you peace. May His countenance look upon you and give you favor. Yah bless.